presentation is about managing DevOps at scale. Implementing DevOps is one thing, but scaling it to the entire enterprise is really challenging. Good day. My name is Rob Akershoek. I'm a DevOps architect at DXC and co-chair of the IT for IT Forum. Now let's have a look at the storyboard of this presentation today. First, we're going to look at how is the digital operating model evolving? What kind of new practices are emerging? And then we're going to look into what kind of capabilities and integration flows you need in your digital value streams. And then we're going to look at how do you optimize end-to-end DevOps journeys and what kind of end-to-end DevOps journeys do you need to optimize? And then we're going to look at how do you see the roles in your organization in a DevOps mode at scale? Now, let's look at how our digital operating model is evolving. This picture shows you what's happening at this moment in a digital operating model. So we see a lot of things changing. We organize around product teams. We use microservices and platforms. Of course, DevOps, where we make teams accountable for the full lifecycle. Continuous delivery, organized around value streams. In the past, we were very process and practice driven, and now we are asked to implement and automate end-to-end value streams. We leverage cloud, containers, multi-vendor sourcing, and I can continue. But the real challenge is that we don't work in this all agile and cloud and container way. We have a hybrid environment that we need to manage. And that's the real challenge when you're working in DevOps at scale. It's a hybrid environment where we have traditional package-based software running on-premise, SaaS applications, custom-built applications, cloud-native applications. So the real challenge is how do you manage all these hybrid environments at the same time? And it's not just about software engineering only or custom built software. It's really about managing the full application and service portfolio. Now, let's have a look at what kind of capabilities do I need to manage this end-to-end digital value chain. And first, we need to look at what kind of value streams do I need. And in this picture, you can see that development and ops, we got four key value streams according to the IT for IT reference architecture. So it's probably good to go through these and demonstrate what kind of capabilities you need and data flows to get end-to-end value stream management. Now let's start with strategy to portfolio. The fundamental element of strategy to portfolio in the at-scale model is that you have a good understanding of your full product portfolio. So understand how the different products deliver value to your customers, how they enable business capability. So that's tightly linked into enterprise architecture. That's where digital operating model starts. Understanding your product portfolio, understand how it enables the business. And then it generates demands, and we capture demands, of course, from the business with new ideas, but also we capture demands based on the existing portfolios like rationalization opportunities, technology refresh, upgrades, and so on. And then we balance that in a full integrated portfolio backlog capability where we manage the epics for new business opportunities, new business products, or also rationalization, decommissioning application and products. So it's really about balancing new and maintaining the current state and enhancing my current portfolio. So this is a very important area, strategy portfolio, defining where to invest in. And then we move into the next value stream. It's basically requirement to deploy, where we have the different product teams. They work from the backlogs. They design, build, and test them, and create their release packages. So this value stream is basically the software engineering or development value stream, where we basically continuously, in a continuous integration, continuous delivery mode, evolve the product and create new value and really and fix problems and issues. And then we're going to deploy them in different environments, such as a test environment, production environment, and so on. And after something is deployed, we can then do the testing in the test environment, and of course, to UAT and to production. But what is very important in a DevOps model is that we look at this third value stream, which is request to fulfill, because a lot of organizations don't have this value stream really implemented in a good way. Because here it's really about getting this consumer experience. So we have many different products that we deliver to our customers, but how do you consume these services? So we need a good service catalog, a request catalog to put all these catalogs in there so people can request access to our services, request additional activities from the DevOps teams to perform managing identity and access, and then provision those requests, automatically provision user rights or provision other activities related to our portfolio. But this is a task for the DevOps teams to build this request catalog, to build this automation as well. And then, of course, when something is provisioned into an operating environment, We hopefully automatically update our configuration repository so we understand exactly what version is running where, what are the dependencies, what infrastructure resources are linked to it, and we apply the right tagging. And then, of course, we start monitoring our services, hopefully more proactive monitoring, do some service failure prediction, and hopefully, as you see here, a kind of automated remediation where we can detect issues before the business is impacted, initiate automated remediation activities, and then basically resolve the issue. But of course, in some cases, we still need to do manual activities around incident management. There are end users asking questions and raise incidents, and we need to resolve them. And to resolve these incidents, typically, we use request again, because hopefully to resolve issues, we can maybe reboot a server, add additional capacity, reconfigure infrastructure components, and so on, which is basically, again, request to fulfill, standardize those automation workflows. And then, of course, if something needs to be fixed, we might sometimes need to go back into the product teams in the request requirement to deploy value stream, where we, let's say there's a problem, we try to fix it, build a solution, and then deploy that. And the last integration is really about continuous improvement, where we evaluate, again, how well is our operations working with the service levels, the cost, the value delivered, the user experience, and that drives input to our service portfolio. And then you get a closed loop here. So what this picture basically is showing is all the capabilities you need and the key data flows that you need to optimize in this digital operating model. Now, it's not about individual capabilities, and it's not about all these individual integrations that you see on this picture. Yes, you need all these integrations, but you also need to focus on the most essential DevOps workflows or end-to-end journeys. And let me explain to you what are the 9 essential end-to-end journeys that you need to optimize in your DevOps model. As you can see in this picture, it starts with an end-to-end idea to market value flow. So from a new demand coming in, then we say this is a new opportunity, a new product. So it's not part of our portfolio. So we need to add a new product in portfolio. We decide, is it a SaaS application? Will it be custom build? Where are we going to host it? And there's a decision made. We assign a team. We create a pipeline and we start deploying it. And we have an MVP running in production. But it's a big end-to-end value stream from idea to getting something into the market. And after something is in the market, we then continuously enhance it. And that's where the requirements to deploy value stream fits in. Capture new requirements, capture new ideas, but also fixing potential problems from production. And then it's basically the continuous delivery flow that we see here. But as I mentioned, the key journey as well is the request to fulfill. We need to make sure that DevOps teams are able to support the end user, provide that optimal user experience, a consumer experience. So it's a request through a portal, they raise a request, it's fulfilled and deployed, and it might be just an access request or could be other type of request. And of course, we get some queries and issues and questions from customers. So as a DevOps team at scale, we also need to support the end users, resolve their issues, maybe through self-service, self-help. So we, as a DevOps team, we maintain a knowledge base, or it's through the service desk. And of course, the end-to-end flow of monitoring, detecting an event, automatically remediate. So the whole incident to remediate activities. And it requires a lot of collaboration between the CMDB, monitoring tools, incident management, automated resolution tools, deployment, again, because we want to reconfigure and solve this issue. So it's really about end-to-end flows here. And the same is when we really have a problem in production that we need to fix. And there is a maybe a workaround, but we implemented the workaround. Now we need to have a permanent fix, like maybe there's a security vulnerability. So we register this problem and it needs to move back from our service management system to the agile backlogs, maybe in Jira or Azure DevOps. We put it into the backlog, they develop and test a new fix and they deploy it. And that's the whole problem to fix workflow. And of course, there are more workflows, like how do you manage continuous compliance, or how do you manage IT financial management, understand the cost and the consumption. And in some cases, when there's a new opportunity detected in the market, we might need to first explore that, create a sort of prototype environment. So it's idea to concept. And as you can see here, these are the 9 essential value streams that you need to optimize, leveraging the different capabilities. And as you can see, a lot of these capabilities are shared across these different value streams and journeys. And that's so important that we standardize a lot of these components so that we can scale all these journeys across the enterprise. And to do that, typically, we leverage different practices. Of course, we use DevOps as a key practice. But to have a digital operating model at scale, DevOps is not the only practice that we need. We might need to think about skilled agile practices like SAFe or enterprise architecture practices like TOGAF. We leverage Scrum for our agile teams and Kanban, but we also use ITIL from a service management perspective, like managing the incidents, change management, request management, configuration management, and so on. You see that many organizations are starting to leverage site reliability engineering practices to automate and to engineer a lot of operations activities like deployment, monitoring, automated remediation, monitoring your service level objectives, for example. And lastly, also NIST from a security perspective, for example. How do we apply the right practices for security operations? Now, what the message here is that you need to blend different practices together in a digital operating model. So typically in an at-scale model, you will need to combine these different practices together. And not just the practices, we also need to think about how do we build this end-to-end tool chain or DevSecOps tool chain to support these end-to-end journeys. And that's really complex because a lot of organizations, when they're running at scale, they have over 100 different tools to manage their IT estate. Typically because there's no standards, if a team selects their own tools, and there's a lot of complexity. So if you want to run a DevOps organization at scale, we need to standardize our ways of working, standardize some of these practices, and also standardize a lot of these tools. Not saying that every team needs to use the same tool, but there is a common set of tools you need. And what's also important to notice is in the middle, you see value stream management. A key new tooling area in this space is value stream management tools that enable you to get this end-to-end value stream analysis and traceability and transparency and get insight and orchestration across these end-to-end value streams. So that's a very important area to focus as well. Now, if you think about scaling DevOps, there are two ways to scale DevOps. One way is, of course, that a product grows bigger. It's a big product, and in skilled agile framework, they typically call that a solution. And multiple teams build this solution, so we have a bigger solution. That's one scaling. And typically, skilled agile framework and less is focused on that. We have large solutions, and they have to release together. But the reality is, I don't want to use these kind of bigger solutions. I rather have smaller teams focusing on their own product. So typically, many organizations don't have that many large solutions. They typically have a lot of applications. For example, we have maybe a few hundreds or 500 applications in our estate. We have a few hundred teams, and we need to scale more in not in size of application or solution, but more the number of applications, the number of customer journeys, and the number of teams. So that's the most important scaling model. Now let's have a look what kind of roles you need and how do you set up that scaling model in this new digital operating model. Now, in this picture, you see one product team, and that product team, of course, becomes accountable for the full life cycle. So they do the product vision, they develop, test, deploy, they manage a request to fulfill, had a consumption experience for the end user, monitoring and resolve issues. But of course, the challenge is that we don't have one team, we got many teams, and this could, many products. We end up maybe with 100 or 200 different products in our ecosystem. So the question is, how do you manage that more at a skilled level? So the next step that you need to take is really look at your digital portfolio, basically looking at your business model. So if you want to scale, you really need to start with the business model. And this example is given that you start with your customer journeys. What are the journeys that the business is operating? And a customer journey typically affects multiple value streams in the business. We talk here about business value streams, not IT value streams. And these value streams from the business are enabled by business capabilities. And then these capabilities are underpinned by the different type of products and applications that we have in IT. And it's really important to build this scaled model. How is the business enabled by IT? And you see that they suddenly also have to manage and work with different owners. So we have the product owners, but we also have the capability owners, the value stream owners, and the customer journey owners. So in a scaled model, you need to look at this business model and identify the owners and teams associated with these. The same as from an architecture perspective. We've got enterprise architecture, domain and solution architects here. Now, so again, we need to start with the product model. And if you don't have a good product model, then your DevOps journey will probably fail. So what you need to start, as I mentioned, is look at this business model from a customer journey down to the business capabilities, down to your products and services that you have. And then the next thing is look at what kind of activities are happening in my organization against these products. Now, in this case, an example from a development perspective, my epics are more related to customer journeys. I got program epics to my value streams or business capabilities. And then I go down to the product feature story level affecting individual products. So it's very important to have this kind of a layered model for your work. That work is linked to the product model, and then the product model is linked to who's delivering this, like the teams and the team of teams. And these three dimensions are very essential. And you should not link work to teams or to team of teams. No, work is associated with the product model. So primarily work is associated with the product model. And based on the product model, you define who is working on this. And today we typically do the other way around. We assign work to organizational entities, being teams or team of teams. Now, again, if you look at these digital products, so we're starting to scale and we group those digital products, as I mentioned, into like clusters of value streams or business capabilities. And some people would call this a product line. Sometimes people refer to ART in the Skilled Agile framework or tribe or domains. But it's very important to, that you have this structure aligned with the business model. Now, what you see here is that this ART, or the, I should maybe better call it a tribe, this tribe is end-to-end accountable. It manages the development and operations. And that's why the ART in the Skilled Agile framework is typically not very well defined, because they only look at development. The ART is not looking at ops. But here you need, in a DevOps at scale, look at both dev and ops from a full life cycle. And on this skilled model, you have specific roles, like maybe the release coordinator that can all coordinate releases from different product teams within one value stream. And of course, then you can scale it up to the enterprise as a whole, where we have other, let's say, roles, let's say the customer journeys, the CIO, the CDO, and the business stakeholders there. So you see here this hierarchical model, but it's not about the organizational hierarchy, it's about the business model hierarchy. Now, the next step is, now we have identified the teams and the products, we also need to look at platforms, because what's very important is we don't just have product teams, we also have platform teams. For example, our cloud platform teams that enable the journeys for on Azure, on AWS. And we also have teams, the platform teams, deliver the digital engineering capabilities, like an IT for IT platform team or a DevOps, SecOps tool chain DevOps teams. Those teams provide the standard capabilities for the teams to deliver value. So basically, there are platform teams supporting all the different teams and clusters to deliver value and support their end-to-end delivery model. So if you think about now looking at these platform teams, so we need to add that as well. So you could see that now we add the platform teams below. So we have different type of teams, the platform teams with their platform owners. There's also a team accountable for that. So now you see how this end-to-end model is building up. Now, the next thing is maybe looking at what kind of roles do I need in this whole model that you just saw. So again, we have the platform teams and we have different type of platform teams, let's say the cloud teams for Amazon, Azure, or the internal data center. We got maybe PaaS platform teams delivering platforms where like an API platform. And we got our DevOps tool chain IT for IT platform teams. Again, the product teams organized around the products and the value streams and the enterprise. And also you see at the bottom our supporting capabilities. So what are the capabilities related to HR and finance? Now, what I want to do now is plot the key roles to it in this operating model at scale, because what you see, if you scale DevOps, you get also different type of roles. So, of course, we start with the product owner role and the product manager role, both for the platform and the product teams. And we might have a value stream owner there as well, of course. And on the enterprise level, maybe a customer journey owner. And in a larger organization, you also see that same level in architecture. We have an enterprise architect looking at the enterprise as a whole. We got our value stream and domain architects looking at a specific domain or a specific value stream, and a solution architect looking at the specific products in the portfolio. And the same what we do have with a cloud architect or an IT for IT DevOps tool architect that enables the platform teams to deliver. And then we have the engineering skills. So on the product teams, they have their software engineering skills, UX designer skills, testing, and so on. And the same you have, of course, in the enabling teams, the platform teams. They have the cloud engineers available, the API specialist, the monitoring and observability specialist. And also here in the enabling platform teams are, for example, the site reliability engineer that can automate those repetitive tasks like deployment, monitoring, and they help the product team to perform these kind of activities. And as of course, part of the model, they need support roles. So in every product team, there is a support role, and it could be combined with the developer having both the development role and the support role. But there is typically people involved with that support specialist role. Data, as you could see, data is becoming a very important asset in any organization. So if you look at an organization at scale, then data becomes, it has a number of their own roles, like a data architect or a chief data officer, data protection officer, data scientist. So you see those roles happening or appearing in this model as well, because they are involved in the digital delivery. Security and compliance, the same. We have people responsible for compliance management, risk management, like a risk analyst, security officer. But what's also important to notice here that security is also embedded in the tribes, in the teams. So they have security specialists within the product teams, within the value streams to enable and make sure security is fully embedded. And of course, we have also people like, for example, related to identity and access management to support this kind of shared service concept for identity. And then there's also still support roles needed across the different teams, typically like a service desk. You don't need every value stream or product team perform their own service desk role. That's typically a shared function where we have some service desk resources that can support the generic questions. They have maybe use a knowledge base and support the end users for frequently asked questions. And the rest is done by the product teams, of course. But there are still other capabilities you need there, like major incident coordination. If there's really a major issue, then you typically need somebody that looks across all the teams and make sure that we can pull all the people together and fix this issue in a short time frame. The same for 24/7 monitoring. That typically the product teams are not always equipped to do their own 24/7 monitoring. So you need a monitoring team that support the product teams. They don't become accountable, but they support them and they can perform automated or standardized operating procedures and basically notify, take some actions. But the rest, of course, is always done by the product teams. And the same you see for security and compliance, the SecOps teams. You typically have a shared SecOps team that monitors security and compliance, vulnerabilities, and coordinate across all the different teams if there's any vulnerabilities found. And then lastly, of course, you have some other roles in specifically the supporting capability space, like vendor management, contract, financial, and HR management. Now, what you see here appearing is it looks very complex, but it basically combines what kind of roles do you need in this scale DevOps model, but also underlying, and as you saw that in the picture before, what kind of capabilities do these teams need to operate? And a lot of these are shared, like sharing portfolio backlogs, sharing service management, sharing monitoring capabilities, and so on. So that's very important to design this operating model with the end-to-end workflows that I just showed you, the end-to-end capability model, and this end-to-end role model. And this is basically my last slide for this presentation. And I would like to thank you for listening to this presentation. Hopefully, you can use some of this material in your own organization. I've seen many organizations struggling with DevOps at scale, and I've seen that if they use this approach, that they can get a lot of value and they can accelerate their journey. So again, thank you very much for listening, and I hope you have a good digital journey yourself.